talk. Please wait for the microphones. And after the talk, we'll have a reception. And I want to introduce our talker today, Steve Cowley. He's the president of Corpus Christi College at Oxford. And he's a graduate of Oxford from undergrad. And then after that, he came to Princeton. And read his PhD. Talking to him while we're coming related to the pairing model. Was awarded the Proctor Fellowship. We had so many fellowships, I don't think I'll go over the awards of the fellowship. But afterwards, he went to Com in the UK, and he did a postdoc, came back to Princeton to work here, applied math. But then he became a faculty at UCLA, and in 2008, he became director of UK Atomic Energy Authority. And the column lab, where the jet automatic and mass automatic are, and then he became the chief of the UK. So last year, he became the president of Corpus College at Oxford University, first scientist of the college is known for classics. So he has a bunch of fellowships, but he's a fellow of the Royal Society and the Royal Academy of Engineers and Physics, and more importantly, maybe, is by GQ, Gentleman's Quarterly, ranked top 100 commercial venue. And for us, more importantly, last year we had the fusion distillers, and he has been kind enough to review that for us. And without further ado,
I'm not sure the GQ thing needs to be mentioned, actually. It'd be fantastic if they'd said I was one of the 100 best-dressed men in Britain. That would be fantastic, but that's not it. I'm going to talk about fusion, and there are a lot of people who know more about fusion than me in the audience, so and this is sort of partly an introductory talk and partly a polemic that I'm pushing these days, because I think that What I see is happening in fusion in Europe and what I see is happening in fusion in America don't actually gel together very well, and I think there's a real need to start thinking about what the priorities are internationally, particularly post-ITER, which is the machine that's being built in France. But I pretty much always start... Oh, there's the Corpus Arms. There's the pelican plucking its breast to make blood to feed its young. That's really the self-sacrifice that we at Oxford do for our students. Absolutely. And really thanks to all the UK AEA team that I'm still actively working with on fusion issues for all the good things about this talk, and I take all the responsibility. I always like to start the talk about fusion with really what's the first mention of fusion as a process, because in 1920, Sir Arthur Stanley Eddington, who was then the president of the British Association, gave a talk to the British Association. It was his presidential address. It was in Cardiff. And the subject of his talk was, what is the sun made of? And it's one of the best public lectures in science that I think I've ever read. It's published in Nature. You can find it online if you want to read the actual text of what he said. And what's so impressive about it is, in fact, it is accessible to a sort of scientifically knowledgeable layperson, and yet a good three-quarters of the lecture is completely new research and his conjectures about how stars work. And this is really not the beginning, but Eddington sort of... working through what the structure of stars must be, and of course this is probably his most famous work, was on the structure of stars, either that or the bending of starlight around the sun, which he also was involved in, if you remember the measurement of that. Anyway, he was pointing out something, and it's rather nice the way he pointed out in his lecture. He was pointing out that everybody had their head stuck in the sand about what the sun was made of. Because back in 1867, I think, Lord Kelvin had said, the sun is you know, it's very simple what stars are. They're just big balls of gas that are falling in on themselves, and as they fall in, you know, the gravitational energy gets converted into pressure, and that pressure is heat, and that holds it up. But then it radiates some energy away, and it falls in a little bit further. Then it radiates some more energy away, and it falls in a little bit further. And if you take this model of the sun, you come up with a lifetime for the sun that's 20 million years. And Eddington says, oh, you know, it can't possibly be 20 million years, the lifetime of the sun. And then he goes through a litany of reasons why, you know, rocks on Earth are billions of years old, etc., etc. So it can't possibly be that. And he says, then, so what's wrong with Kelvin's argument? I mean, where else could the energy be given? He says there must be some source of energy inside the sun. And like in a lot of cases in science, he was lucky, right? He was lucky because Aston had just perfected sort of high-precision mass spectrometry. And he had measured the masses of hydrogen and helium very precisely at this time. And I probably can't work out. I can work out the laser. That's very good, yeah. And basically, the mass of hydrogen in atomic units is 1.008, and the mass of helium is 4. And Eddington says, you know, if what the sun is doing is turning 4 hydrogen into 1 helium, then there is some mass left over. And if there's mass left over, M equals MC squared, there's energy. And every student who's ever done any elementary nuclear physics does these kind of calculations to work out binding energies, etc., of nuclei. And what's really clever about this, of course, is he doesn't actually have to know anything about nuclear physics, because in 1920, we didn't even know there was a neutron inside the nucleus. All he has to know is E equals mc squared and some conjecture that what was happening was that hydrogen was being turned into helium. And he goes on to say, oh, you know, if the sun converts 1/3 of its mass from hydrogen to helium, and we know the luminosity of the sun, how old, you know, how long will the sun last? And he comes up with 10 billion years, which is a pretty good estimate, really. Of the solar lifetime. And this conjecture on his part is the first conjecture of sort of what nuclear energy could be. It's the conjecture that you can transmute one element into another by some kind of nuclear process, and we know this process as fusion. And Eddington goes on to speculate in very flowery kind of semi-Victorian language that maybe one day we'll be able to harness this energy source and power the planet with it. It's funny how we always refer to the Earth as the planet when we're talking in an environmental context. It's one of the planets, not the planet. Sorry, little pet peeves of mine. The story moves on. And here the history of fusion gets a little bit confusing, because there was some kind of work. I remember Hans Fleischmann at Cornell telling me that it had all been invented really in Cornell in the 1930s, but never believed anything that Hans said anyway. So, but there's a very interesting piece of history related to this. This is a report that was produced by Philip Moon, who was one of the British people at Los Alamos during the bomb project during the Second World War. And at the end of the bomb project, there was a wrap-up meeting. It was in November of 1945, so after VJ Day. And it was a wrap-up meeting in which all the luminaries of Los Alamos speculated about the future and said, you know, what could happen in the future? What could we do in the future that would be really exciting and we should all get involved in? Some of it was about making hydrogen bombs, and actually part of this paper had partly to do with that. But this meeting was known, I think it was known to Russell and Spitzer and people at the beginning of the Princeton project, but there were no notes allowed to be taken at this meeting because it was speculative, and people who've looked in the classified archive at Los Alamos said there are no notes from this meeting. However, see, the British at this time knew that America was going to shut us out of nuclear secrets. In 1946, the McMahon Act was passed and said that, you know, British were no longer allowed to have access to American nuclear secrets in 1946. And we knew this was going to happen by that time. And so by the end of the bomb project, British intelligence was collecting as much information as it could from Los Alamos in order to start the British bomb project when we all got back to Britain. I mean, there were, you know, people like Rudolf Piles, etc., and particularly William Penny, who started the British bomb project after that, who had been key members at Los Alamos. But so Moon, when he went back to his room the night after Fermi gave this particular lecture, wrote notes up on this, and these notes were collected from him and brought back to Britain. And on these notes, this is the one from Sir John Cockcroft's archive at Churchill College. They were later declassified because in this note, he talks about fusion reactions, what temperatures you need, what the radiation, etc. was. And at the end of it, he speculates about magnetic confinement. And one of the things he shows is that you can't just use a purely toroidal field to confine a plasma. So this seems to be the first time anybody very seriously sat down and tried to think how you could control a thermonuclear plasma at temperatures of, he was talking about 27 kilovolts in this paper. And it's a very interesting little piece of the archive. You can see, basically, this is James Chadwick, who was the leader of the British mission to Los Alamos at that time. So we move it forward, and this is rapid bit through history. This is what... okay, the plasma physicists in the audience think that was a big skip through history. But this is the ITER site. This is where ITER is supposed to sit, and that's the middle. This is the assembly hall right here. It's a striking building with polished stainless steel on the outside, so we've got to finish this, because otherwise it's the most striking white elephant you've ever seen. It is actually a fantastic building. This is where ITER will sit, and the office buildings are over here, and back here, this poloidal field building is over here. It's coming along, you know, actual progress is taking place, although, as we all know, the cost and the scale of ITER and the progress on its build have been distinctly halved. So let's do a little bit more, get into the physics a bit. ITER is a toroidal containment device. So basically, it's a toroidal solenoid with niobium tin superconducting magnets that are about coils that are about 12 meters tall, wrapped around a vacuum vessel here, in which the plasma is contained in a torus and a tokamak configuration. A D-shaped, what we call triangular cross-section here. Down here is the exhaust system, the diverter. These niobium tin coils have a field of 11.8 tesla on the inboard edge, which is really at the limit of niobium tin technology and superconducting technologies. It now stands for large coils. There is no way to take the magnetic field to anything much stronger than that at the moment. Well, I say there's no way. There are possibilities that we can do this with high-temperature superconductors, but at the moment, this is the limit of the technology. The greater than sign always helps you with ITER. It's supposed to start on, I think, November the 23rd, 2025. And the fusion power in the baseline activity is about 500 megawatts. The burn flat top greater than 400 seconds. Power amplification, which is defined for fusion as fusion power out divided by power going in to heat the plasma, not the power going in to cool the coils, for instance. And the cost is greater than $12 billion, and I think that's an acceptable figure that I'm allowed to say it's greater than. at this point. The reaction that everybody in fusion wants to do is between two isotopes of hydrogen. This is deuterium, and in my picture, protons are green and neutrons are blue. It's just, they aren't in real life. And this is tritium, super heavy hydrogen, one proton, two neutrons, and deuterium, one proton, one neutron. This is the easiest fusion reaction to do, and it's one of God's little jokes that the easiest fusion reaction to do involves a substance that has a half-life of 12.4 years. Because it would be nice if tritium just simply occurred in nature and that we could just dig tritium out of seawater or something like that. But you have to make tritium from bombarding lithium with a neutron and creating helium and tritium from lithium-6 is the most predominant reaction. Of course, the problem with fusion is that in order to get a fusion reaction to happen, you've got to get over the natural electrostatic repulsion of two nuclei, and that means bringing them together within the distance in which the strong force acts, which will bind them together to form a compound nucleus in this case. And so the only way we really know how to do that is to have your deuterium and tritium running round at great speed. As they approach each other, they repel, but if they're hitting smack on and they come within a nuclear distance, then deuterium and tritium will form helium-5 in the J3 halved state is the state that it goes into. And because this is a resonant interaction, the cross-section for this interaction of deuterium and tritium is about 100 times larger than any other fusion reaction. So anybody who suggests you start doing fusion in anything else besides deuterium and tritium or to try this one first and prove they can do it with deuterium and tritium and move up to the more complicated fusion reactions. Of course, the byproduct is helium with one-fifth of the energy, 3.5 megavolts of energy, and a neutron with energy about 14 megavolts of energy. The typical energies you need to bring these together with is center of mass energies of 20-30 kilovolts, something like that, which means a temperature of your plasma between 200 and 300 million degrees centigrade. And of course, the great difficulty of making fusion actually go is creating an environment, a containment of your deuterium and tritium with a magnetic field so that you can reach those unbelievable temperatures. People always say about fusion, oh, well, you know, you can't possibly, how could you have a sun in a bottle? The remarkable thing is, actually, this bit's been done rather successfully, first at TFDR up the road at the Princeton Plasma Physics Lab, and then at JET in Cullum in the UK. And actual containment of plasma has been done, and actually we can do fusion and create the conditions for fusion. We haven't yet done fusion at a level which is self-sustaining, and I'll talk about that in a moment, and that's really the goal of ITER. This bit here, you can certainly do this reaction and try this reaction, can happen at ordinary temperatures. So the wall of your fusion reactor contains lithium in what we call a blanket in various different forms, and I won't describe that because I'm going to go through that physics at the moment, but the lithium in the wall is there, and it absorbs the energy of the neutron and creates your tritium in the wall. And one of the big technological difficulties of doing deuterium-tritium fusion is then extracting your tritium that's in the wall and putting it back into your plasma and having a sustained reaction. Now, the reason this is a very attractive thing to do is there's about 60 billion years' worth of deuterium to power the planet in seawater, and of course there won't be a planet in more than 5 billion years from now, so that's adequate. Lithium, if you can extract it efficiently from seawater, and there are various ways suggested of doing this, you probably wouldn't do that at the beginning of a fusion economy, but if you can, there's about 30 billion years worth of powering the planet of lithium in seawater. So the real promise of fusion has always been that you have this sort of incredible supply of fuel and that could go on for an awful long time. And of course, the other part of that is your byproducts are helium. I always joke that you could, you know, fill up birthday balloons with the helium. And I'm not sure that any mother would trust you giving helium from a fusion reactor for a birthday balloon, but anyway. Or father, for that matter. So the containment that we have, the containment in fusion in a magnetic field, is designed to contain the orbits of the particles so that they don't touch the wall. Obviously, particle moving at about 1,000 kilometers a second and having to contain your plasma for seconds, the particles inside the plasma for seconds, means that the orbit of the particle will have to be substantially contained inside your magnetic field and not touch the wall. And this is just a nice little graphic of the orbits of deuterium ion moving inside the field of jet. This is what we call a banana particle. And the Lama radius, which is the radius of these little spirals here, is rho I is, I'm going to use the notation rho I is that radius of that spiral. Now, simple considerations. I think, you know, when people like Fermi et al. Were asking, is it at all practical to do fusion? And he was mainly looking in that case at deuterium fusion because he didn't think that they could make that much tritium. You're asking questions like, can you get sufficient power density in order to make a decent sized amount of power out of a substantial piece of machine? So one of the things people do is they propose all kinds of exotic fusion reactions that have very, very low power density. Deuterium tritium, which by far has the largest power density for confined pressure of your plasma, you can represent the fusion power per meter cubed in megawatts per meter cubed by this handy dandy little formula here that I use all the time. And this is the pressure of the plasma in atmospheres squared. And this works, well, it doesn't quite work out to temperatures you want, but it's pretty good between 100 and 200 million degrees centigrade. So roughly in the fusion temperature range, this works pretty well. Now the thing is, the reason I put it in these units is if you wanted to make a gigawatt power station, which is a typical power station you might want to make, you don't want the gigawatt power station to be the size of a baseball stadium. It's going to have to be the size of a reasonable sized object, because you're going to have to put this in a magnetic field and you're going to have it inside a big vacuum vessel, etc. So 1,000 cubic meters would be pretty good. And if you want to contain it with a magnetic field, the pressure of a magnetic field, again in handy-dandy formula, is 4 times B squared measured in Tesla atmosphere. And superconducting magnets can do things like, let's take ITER. ITER, the magnetic field, is 5 Tesla, 5.2 Tesla in the middle of the plasma. It's 11.8 on the coil, but in the middle of the plasma, 5.2. So that's 25, it's B squared times 4, so you've got a magnetic pressure of 100 atmospheres. But we know that we can't utilize the magnetic pressure completely in magnetic containment, and we can only use a few percent of it. So, in fact, the central pressure inside a ITER shot is about 7 atmospheres of pressure. So P squared is about 49. And you're talking here about something like 4.5 or so megawatts per meter cubed in the middle of, that's the power density in the middle of ITER. And there you can see, that's only the middle ITER and the edges, about 1,000 cubic meters you have in ITER is going to give you something like the intended power level of 0.5 gigawatt of power out of it. Plasma physicists tend to turn this into fusion power in terms of beta, which is the ratio of pressure to B squared. Ratio of magnetic plasma pressure to magnetic pressure is beta. And it's a key parameter in how well your fusion reactor works. If you can get high beta, it's great because you get a lot of pressure and you don't have to
pay so much for your magnetic field. Because ultimately the cost of your reactor is going to be some function, positive function, of the size, goes up with size, and it goes up with magnetic field. Some people say it scales roughly like the stored energy, magnetic energy. Anyway, beta is a key parameter of how good your magnetic confinement system is, and then it's proportional to V to the fourth. And people often point out, isn't this wonderful? You know, if you could double your magnetic field, you could get 16 times as much energy. And this is wonderful, but we're at the moment pretty much at the limit of superconducting technology. And perhaps in a decade or so, or two decades, we'll be able to increase that. But you're already talking, I mean, once you get up to 10 Tesla, you're talking 400 atmospheres of pressure. Now, a typical pressurized water reactor has a pressure of about 150 atmospheres of pressure. Nucleus engineers do not like to go to huge pressure. So 400 atmospheres of pressure is already a pretty large pressure. You're up to 20 Tesla, which people are talking about now, you've gone up to 1,600 atmospheres of pressure. The bottom of the Marianas Trench in the Pacific Ocean is 1,000. So there you are, 1.6 times the pressure at the bottom of the Pacific Ocean. So let's go back to what ITER's trying to do. So ITER's trying to contain your deuterium and tritium, the pink bit here. I was joking because of the maps, pink was always the colour of the British Empire. The pink bit is your plasma, and in the middle of this plasma, you've got your deuterium and tritium reactions going on. And the deuterium and tritium reactions produce a charged particle, the helium, and a neutron. The charged particle is captured by the magnetic field, stays inside the plasma, plows through the plasma, slowing down by giving up its energy to the other charged particles in there, and provides heat inside the plasma. So the fusion can self-heat through this particle. The neutron does not get captured by the magnetic field, crosses, and in ITER, if you're lucky, it will hit one of the modules that are designed to test blanket performance and do a little bit of breeding of tritium, but ITER is not going to breed its own tritium. It's going to consume tritium largely produced in heavy water reactor. So the key thing here is if we get an ITER performance of 500 megawatts of power, there'll be 100 megawatts of self-heating in ITER, and 400 megawatts of neutrons flying into the wall and just causing damage. A little bit of breeding of tritium. Again, using my handy-dandy units here, the simple consideration, something called the Lawson criterion, is the way energy is lost. So what's happening inside that magnetic cage is that the fusion reactions are partly heating the plasma. They're providing 100 megawatts of self-heating. We are injecting energy through neutralized particles into the plasma and through microwaves. In ITER, up to about 70 megawatts of heating power into the plasma. The plasma is losing energy due to turbulent transfer. The middle is hot, the edge is cold, and there's kind of bubbling motions that carry the heat from the middle to the edge. And those bubbling motions have only just been able to calculate in the last decade or so with some fidelity. It's one of the great triumphs of theoretical plasma physics was the ability through something called gyrokinetic theory, and some of the experts are in the audience, to be able to calculate the turbulent transport of the heat from the middle to the outside. But actually, what we do is we characterize it in an empirical sense by a number called tau e, the energy confinement. And the power lost by transport from the plasma is just defined as the energy stored in the plasma divided by this time. And the time you actually need is typically a few seconds in ITER. Because if you then say, okay, the power lost is replaced by the fusion heating due to the helium, that you produce in your fusion reactions. So you're in balance. Your fusion heating is balanced by the losses. That's called basically the Lawson criterion, although I've exaggerated, it's not quite what Lawson said. But that gives you a criterion that you have to exceed in the product of the pressure times the energy confinement time. This is pressure in atmospheres, this is energy confinement time in seconds, and that has to be bigger than 20 in these curious units. So typically, with a pressure of 7 atmospheres in the middle of ITER and a confinement time of about 3 to 4 seconds, you will get into roughly this self-heated regime. That's the goal, because in the 1990s, CFER here at Princeton and JET got to the conditions of fusion, but the amount of self-heating that the plasma had was negligible. The plasma was not heating itself. And if it's not heating itself, you have a very inefficient system for eventually producing fusion power. Now this is a bit controversial.
This is some simulations by Bob Budley, and I'm just digging them for this talk. But this is based on some modelling in which various parameters in some of the best models of plasma transport have been varied to look at the sensitivity in ITER of whether it will get to that self-heated state. So it's good to ask yourself, okay, so how does ITER start out? So at time t equals zero here, you put deuterium and tritium gas inside that toroidal vacuum vessel. The superconducting magnets are on, because they're on all the time, basically. And what you then do is you induce about 15 milliamps of current to flow around that loop. You do that by changing the magnetic flux through the middle of the torus, what you call the solenoid, and you induce current. But when you induce current in ITER, in this phase from zero up to this point here, temperature will go up to, 1 or 2 or 3 kilovolts during that time. It doesn't get hot enough to see any significant fusion. Then what you do at this time is you turn on ITER's heating system with 70 megawatts of heater power into the plasma. This is combined sources of neutral particles moving at about a megavolt of energy and electron cyclotron heat. And then what happens, and let's look at the blue line, because that's the one that's probably closest. Well, it's an optimistic line, so I'll present the optimistic case. But the cognoscenti, I think it has a pedestal temperature of 5.2, which is not overly optimistic. Anyway, 70 megawatts of power go in, and then the central temperature, in a matter of seconds, rises up to about 23 kilovolts, so 230 milli degrees. And you can see here the blue line going up and down here. This is relaxation oscillations in the middle of the plasma called sawtooth oscillation. Now, at this point, what do you do with your plasma? You've now got it going, and what we're plotting, sorry, I should have said this, up this side, is fusion power in megawatts coming out of the plasma. So at this point, 70 megawatts of input power producing almost 600 megawatts of fusion power. Then at the next point, what happens here is you bring down the heating power to 50 megawatts, and then you sustain it out to 400 seconds, and you essentially bring it to zero at this point. There may be some power you need for control, etc., but you essentially bring it to zero at this point. And what you can see is that your blue line at that point settles down into a steady output. The plasma at this point is totally self-heated. This is what we call ignition. And if ITER got to ignition, it would exceed what is called its baseline performance. Its baseline performance would be basically what we call Q equals 10 would be 500 megawatts out and 50 megawatts in. That would be what's been promised for ITER. If it actually got to this completely self-heated state of ignition, I think that should be on. It's very interesting when you get close to this. It's enormously sensitive to the model and the parameters. You change things, scan 4, for instance,
There's no flushing of the helium from the plasma. So the helium builds up inside the plasma until it dilutes the fuel and in the model and shuts the reaction off. What I generally conclude from this is that it's really an experiment. ITER is not a demonstration. It's an experiment, and we'll have to work very hard to try and achieve these kind of parameters inside. But that's the point. If you get to that point, you've kind of shown that fusion is scientifically viable. A self-heated plasma continues. It's going to be a historic experiment. I really want to be there when it happens. I'm not sure I'll live that long, but anyway.
Does ITER have to be that big?
There's lots of stuff around that says, oh no, we can do much better than that, we can do much better than that. My experience with JET over the last few years, last month, much better performance, but over the last few years, is you have to work very, very hard to get the kind of levels of performance that we'll see there, and that if ITER had been built any smaller, it would have been a mistake. And so when various colleagues in the press have said that they could do it in something smaller, I am very, very dubious of that. I think that we did the right thing to go for something that big. The difficulties of building it have been immense, and I keep sitting on various review committees, and you know, there isn't a lot of light at the end of the tunnel, except that when you go and look at the building site right now, you see the technology coming out of the ground. It's going to be built, and we are going to get to this stage, and it's going to be, you know, tearing your hair out all the way to the end, but ITER will happen. One of the other ways we know, and I've already made this plug, is that fusion turned a corner, I think, at the end of the 90s, as we started to be able to actually calculate the turbines. Because up to that point, very, very fine work on empirical ways in which the plasma scaled the turbulence. But there was really no calculational basis for the understanding the way the heat got from the middle to the outside. Therefore, the whole basis of designing ITER, designing all machines up beyond that point, were scaling laws that were based on fitting to the experiments. Clever stuff, but I would contend that we made a real step forward with being able to actually calculate things. We're not quite there yet. What we can't really do with those calculations is really optimize. We can just about fit some of the experiments, but we can't yet really optimize the situation and said, actually, the experiment you really wanted to build was something that looked like this and not like that. And I think one of the things I have continually encouraged the theoreticians to do is to kind of try and make that transition between just being reactive to what happened in the experiments, proactive towards something that might be better than we currently have. I'm going to do a little bit more math. The energy confinement time. Now, when people couldn't design airplanes on computers, what they mainly did was find out what the lift and the drag, etc., would depend on, and then fit those numbers to tests in wind tunnels, etc., where you've got the numbers in front of the scaling laws. Right. And we did this in plasma physics in the 80s, was looking at what could the energy confinement time actually depend on inside the plasma. And under some fairly general assumptions, you can show, this was due to Connor and Taylor in 1978 actually, it was that the energy confinement time times the frequency, which is the cyclotron frequency at which they go around the magnetic field lines, should scale like whatever this rho star cube, basically. Now, rho star is the ion-Larmor radius, the radius of the spiral of the ions, divided by some scale length of the plasma. So maybe the distance from the middle to the outside of the plasma. And then it's times some function of all the dimensionless variables that go into it. So this is a way of getting around the fact that we can't quite calculate everything in here. We know it must depend on these dimensionless variables. Here's beta again, which is the ratio of the plasma pressure to magnetic field pressure. Here's a measure of how collisional the plasma is. Then there's factors to do with the shape of the magnetic field, and then the ratio of Me to Mi and various other dimensional quantities. But it's very interesting here that the energy confinement time goes 1 over the rho star cube, which means that the size of the device is cubed on the top. So you double the size of the device, you get 8 times the confinement if you keep all the other dimensionless quantities going. And the usual argument why this is so, is here's your turbulent plasma. Here's a picture from Candy and Walsh's simulations in General Atomics. And the size of these turbulent eddies are bringing hot stuff out and cold stuff back in again. And the size of these eddies is scales with the marmorates. So what's happening to heat is it's working its way out by going halfway around an eddy, then maybe back inwards, then maybe outwards. And so if you think about the sort of random turbulent warp of energy from the middle to the outside, the step length of that random warp is something that scales with the Lama rays. And so if you want to go from the middle to the outside by a random walk, you take n steps to go a distance L. You can work out what n is, it's just L over rho squared. That's the number of steps you take from the middle to the outside. And on ITER, that's about 1 million steps. It takes you about 1 million turbulent steps to go from the middle of ITER to the outside. And what slows the turbulent heat loss from there to there is it has to go further. Right? But it's more than that. You can understand the scaling in realizing that the eddy, these turnover rates here, must depend on the temperature difference across an eddy. And therefore, if the temperature gradient, if it's a bigger device, the time for an eddy to turn over will be longer. And that eddy turnover time scales, and I'm not completely justifying this, like the size of the device divided by the velocity of an ion. So that scales like the size too. And so when you put that together and say the energy confinement time is the number of steps times the time it takes you to take one step, you come up with this formula. That's what we call gyro-bone scaling. But it basically says that the energy confinement time of a plasma scales like the cube of the size of the device times the magnetic field squared. So bigger machines with bigger magnetic field confine for longer. And actually, that scaling is largely held in practice. And we know this. I have to keep publicizing Cowley, even though I'm not running Cowley anymore. This is the inside of JET, the new JET. This is the tungsten on the bottom. This is the beryllium up the side. This is the robotic maintenance system inside JET at this moment. And what we know about the energy confinement time comes from a huge database and lots of marvelous experiments all around the world, some here at Princeton, some at General Atomics, some Asian tokamaks and German tokamaks, and a lot in JET and TFDI, which were the biggest machines that ever operated, and therefore the closest to the performance of ITER. If you take the energy confinement time, the engineering way of doing this was to scale the energy confinement time with the current in the plasma, the magnetic field, the power. This is not pressure, unfortunately. It's same notation. The density. This is the atomic weight. This is the major radius, etc. This is shape factors. And fit basically all the parameters in this formula. And get, this is the experimental, let's see, which is theory and experiment. This is experimental and this is the fit, right? And this shows you the goodness of the fit. It is log-log, right? And, but when you work out what this means, is it means that the energy confinement scales, indeed, almost like rho star to the minus 3, which is the argument. is working up to saying that we have sort of a basic idea of...
what we often do,
in order to say, this is energy confinement, so what we would like to do with energy confinement is make it better.
So what people do is they stick a factor in front of this and they call it H,
which is sort of your fudge factor. And if we did better, we could scale, we could make a bigger H, and H goes into these formula in a funny way. When you convert into the units in the way I'm doing it up there,
remove power from the formula, you get an H to the 2.2 in here.
Now, in the experiment, this H here can vary between, in good plasmas, it's around 1, but it sort of varies around 1 by factors of order 30%. But when you square, take it to the 2.2 power, that variation makes quite a lot of difference in this formula. And one of the things you'll find in the literature is people tend to claim things by saying, maybe we'll take H to be 2 or 2.5 or 3 or something, and then you find that actually fusion works much better.
And then you're surprised.
So that using the sort of dimensional scaling, going back to dimensional things, we find that basically the condition to get to ignition looks something like this. That you have to get the beta in the plasma times b to the fourth, L cubed, times this number F, which is this set of dimensionless numbers that depend on how good your confinement is. This is where all the clever physics can come in, and this is where all the clever physics can come in. Then the rest of it is engineering, because B depends on the quality of your superconducting magnet. If we can get to 20 tesla magnets, mean supporting those enormous pressures in your magnets, then we would go up roughly from the ITER type magnetic field by almost a factor of 2, which would mean 16 times on that, which means that you could scale back in the size of the device, for instance. You wouldn't have to build quite as big a device if you could get to those high magnetic fields. This would be good. But actually, it would probably be better to make the physics better. Because then you maybe wouldn't have to go to these enormous pressures and enormous sizes, which makes a lot of cost. If we could just improve on the physics here, it would be very helpful. But if we took this seriously, and this is what Europe has done, this sort of getting to the point of my talk. If you took this seriously, and you said, okay, now I want to build a device that would actually make net electricity and it would be, able to be with a certain amount of reliability, we could exhaust the plasma, etc. You come up with a device that we... is this showing? No, it's supposed to play. Is it playing? You never know. Let's see. Yeah, go back. Try one more time. It was a picture we produced of the maintenance system of ITER, of a demo. So Europe has designed a demo. Does this mean none of my movies will now work?
I'm going to go backwards and forwards again. Yeah, this is going to work. Oh, no. There we go.
Come on.
I'll play it not in full screen mode and see if we can get this to go. So, Europe has had this demo program going. The idea was to design, what we decided we should do was try and design something that didn't push the envelope too far.
In other words, it was a very conservative design for a fusion reactor based on essentially no physics extrapolation, essentially no engineering extrapolation, and just biting the bullet and saying, this is not a commercial object, so it's going to produce electricity at an immense cost per unit of electricity, but it would be a functioning reactor. We call this early demo. And I'm showing you this because it had to have a robotic maintenance system that we designed at Cowley, because we do a lot of robotic maintenance for jet. And here is sections of the diverter cassette coming out. You'll see sections of the blanket being lifted out of here. This machine is 9 meters in major radius. It's 9 meters from there to there. And the size of the hot cells, the size of the structures around it, is football fields full of places that you have to store irradiated objects. As a concept for a future reactor, it really started to stretch credibility. And I think some people were starting to say, okay, but you know, if we present this as the culmination of fusion, it's not really attractive enough to anybody ever want to build this. 9 meters major radius, pushing the edge of 9 meters. Things. Actually, the ITER system doesn't work, because it simply won't handle the heat flux coming out of the plasma. It was really something, I think, that has frightened us all. But we in Europe, so you're not going to stare at that again, we'll move on. We're not the only ones who said it. What we said is we need a roadmap to fusion, we need a roadmap to get to electricity by the middle of the century. Because we cannot just, you know, do ITER, then sit around for a bit and think. We need to really think how we're going to do ITER and then immediately transition into a program to make some electricity. And I think that that is right. We need to make some electricity. Nobody's going to think fusion is real until we make some electricity. And I originally thought that the concept of building something that was really, you know, didn't stretch credibility too much was, didn't stretch current technology too much, was a very good idea. But I think what we found out of it is actually the object that we have made is unpleasantly large and probably infeasible. Once you get to those sizes, it sets another set of problems, part of which is the fact that the surface area to volume ratio has got so small that things like your exhaust system is just unworkable. And also, the business of building a 9-meter device, an ITER may cost us 15, 20 billion. Well, the 9-meter device that actually makes some electricity, how much is that going to be? And are we ever going to be allowed to spend that kind of money to make that device? So, we weren't the only ones who said that we should do something like this. The Chinese designed CFETR was essentially a move on China to try and immediately, almost simultaneously with ITER, go for electricity producing machine. And some, they've started to back away from some of the original goals of this machine to a much more modest set of goals, but that was true too, and this was going to be operational in the 2030s. And this, of course, was the Korean one. And you can see there's not a lot of engineering gone into this so far. But this was the plan. As you go up in size, the issue of power handling becomes harder and harder. Basically, you know, supposing we keep the plasma pressure about the same, then the heat per unit volume just goes up like volume, so it goes like L cubed. And the way the heat comes out of Topmax is it comes out, it leaks out due to the turbulence, and it comes out in a scrape-off layer, and it follows magnetic field outside the plasma until it basically hits a plate down the bottom here. And the width of this layer, called the scrape-off layer, seems to scale proportionately, basically, to the Larmor radius. The Larmor radius, maybe with some other scale factors around it, say colloidal Larmor radius, whatever, but it basically does not scale with the size of the machine. So you double the size of the machine, but the width of this little point where all the heat that's coming out hits here does not change. And so the surface area goes only like 2 pi r around the device, and therefore only scales linearly with the size of the device. So as you get to bigger and bigger devices, you get into a problem that your power per unit area is getting extremely hard to handle. And on the 9-meter device, we were talking numbers like 70 megawatts per square meter, which nobody thinks any materials could possibly handle. And I think I've said that. And the power per unit area on the diverter basically scales like these parameters in terms of the things you can play with. This is the beta of the plasma, this is the B, the magnetic field, and this is the size, one of your units of size. So people have said, oh, maybe we can do better, and we will go to smaller machines but higher magnetic field. Actually, that doesn't help you. Because when you work out what you do, suppose you said, I'm just going to hit ignition and stay at ignition, make the machine smaller and make the magnetic field bigger in order to make up for the fact that I made the machine smaller. If you do that, the power per unit area just goes up from L to the minus 7. If you really want to make a machine that we know can handle its power, you have to make it very big and very low field. And if you make it, as you scale the size up, you scale the field down, then you can handle the power. However, if you look into these things, if you actually could do better with your confinement, this is your confinement enhancement number, then you can build a better device. And then you could lower the power per unit area and maybe make it easier to handle. The other problems that come up with these things, okay, this is what happens to tungsten when you put it on the walls of a fusion device. This is 5 years, this is irradiation time. You stick tungsten on the wall of your device, and after 5 years, it transmutes. And these are the concentrations in parts per million here. Here you can see iridium, tantalum, osmium, rhenium. You're making rare earths inside your fusion device, and you're changing the constituents of the materials on the wall because they're being bombarded with neutrons. This is actually what happens after your time 5 years in. So this is the isotopic composition of your wall by that time. Nobody quite knows what's the strength characteristics or the brittle characteristics of tungsten at that point. And I'm not sure that you'll really want to extract and sell the rhenium. It's expensive stuff, but probably not in that isotopic combination. We've been doing a lot of analysis of the way the neutrons are distributed around the walls of that fusion reactor. And the problem being that the walls are going to degrade with time. And they're going to degrade because we're basically creating dislocations in the wall, and this is a cascade due to one neutron hitting the wall here and the defects produced, and the resulting embrittlement of the walls. The tools are getting tremendous to do this right now. We're able to calculate, you can see here, a quite sophisticated design and exactly what happens in the transmutations in the walls, etc., and the neutron spectrum all over the device. This is great, but what it's leading to is real concerns about the constituents of the walls. This is a list of the different materials you might put in your walls and the different positions you might put them in your reactor, because you might have tungsten down at the bottom and you might have on the walls, you might want to have, well, you definitely wouldn't want to have beryllium, right? Because this basically embrittlement times of 11 days like that. It's just a heat. It's not a substance. However, there is some hope here, if you look at the numbers, and I'm not really going to read them out because there's a heck of a lot of material here. If you look at the numbers, that we might be able to have walls that last 10 years or something like that. But we will have to design reactors in which replacing everything is quick and easy.
Nuclear reactors are lovely because you've just got those fuel rods that you can pull in and out, and they can now fuel these things while they're online, while they're producing electricity. Take out a fuel rod, put another one in. And the embrittlement of the casing of the fuel rod is not such a problem because we replace it every now and again very efficiently, and we don't interrupt the power you're producing. We've got to figure ways to get the walls of our reactors replaceable in that kind of very easy, interchangeable way. And then we will make some of these materials problems, we will engineer them to be a lot easier. But the problem seems to be, you know, we're heading for fusion reactors if we take this sort of conservative route that Europe has taken. It's not the route that the US has taken. We take the conservative route, we're heading for fusion reactors that are worse than the current problem in Britain at the moment with fission reactors. We're building, we're supposed to be building 16 gigawatts of new installed capacity of nuclear for Britain. A typical day in Britain is 40 gigawatts of electrical power is produced by the national grid. And so 16 gigawatts would be a sizable proportion of the country's electricity. And this is the way we're going to meet our carbon targets by 2050 in Britain. And if you look at all the scenarios through our Department of Energy and Climate Change, all of them require at least 16 gigawatts. The rest may be provided by carbon capture and storage and by wind. The first, however, we're struggling to be able to build even one reactor. We have no problem with nuclear protests. The British people seem to like nuclear power. They see the reasons why. It's how we're going to tackle climate change, in Britain anyway. Although, of course, we can't tackle climate change in Britain. It has to be a global tackling of it. But it's accepted. The problem is finance. These two are 1.6 gigawatt EPRs, which are the French Areva reactors. They're going to cost, well, with finance, 24 billion, without the finance charges, just only 18 billion. And they're going to produce electricity at a cost that, compared to typical gas-fired power stations, is about a factor of 1.5 to 2 times the cost. This is the problem. It's the cost of these reactors and the size. And the key component of the cost here is the financing. We cannot borrow money for projects of this size at the typical rates that you can borrow money for small projects. You might be borrowing money at the moment for small projects at the 2 to 3%. But for this, we have to pay 11 to 13%. And we're borrowing the money from the Chinese to build a French reactor in Britain. You can imagine how that's felt. The strategy on nuclear in Britain has been, we just need to produce some reactors that make some money, and then people will be convinced that we should go on. This is probably a pragmatic strategy, but at the moment it seems to be failing rather heavily due to this. And there is a growing feeling that we have to go smaller, that we have to go to modular reactors built in factories that are easy to produce, maybe between 50 megawatts and, say, 160 megawatts. The reactors in that range have been proposed. This country has done a lot of work in that. British government has to put aside $250 million towards funding small modular reactor programs because with small modular reactors, you change the whole financing system for it very dramatically. And it seems with fusion that we really have to take this lesson seriously. When we did the National Research Council review of the NIF program back about 4 years ago, one of the presentations we had was from an energy financier who said that if you get to things in the 20 billion range, none of the American utilities are capitalized enough to fund that. And therefore, you've just made an object that, however efficient it is not suitable.
Steve, question. In your previous slide, you said 80-year lifetime. That's not the time it would take for
No, it pays off in under 20 years. The finance people will not... That's how they've set the cost of electricity. So the government has guaranteed the cost of electricity on that power station of £92 per megawatt hour. Right, and that's set in order for them to meet their finance charges and pay off in under 20 years. Well, can we do fusion at compact scale? And what do you actually mean by compact? Because, you go out and various people at various American defense contractors are proposing things that go and apply to airplanes. That's not going to be possible because mean free paths of neutrons mean that the blanket, for instance, will have to be roughly a meter thick or maybe a bit more depending on exactly what reading ratio you want, etc. And they'll be heavy. And so the chances that you can make fusion reactors that are, compact enough you can put them in an aeroplane are essentially zero. But we can go quite a lot more compact. These are pictures. This was a column.
Would you have to make a gradient?
Well, you still have to stop the pilots being irradiated by neutrons. It's true, you might decide that you'll breed the tritium elsewhere and carry it in the back of your aeroplane. A crash would be an interesting thing. This is a picture from the 2005 of the column. This was a component test facility. It was a driven machine. But this is a demonstration that in spherical tokamaks, there are ideas how we might bring down the cost and scale of fusion. I don't have time, and I think I've run out of time, but I don't quite know what. We'll bring down the cost and scale of fusion. And this machine here, John Lennard, has been proposing spherical tokamak reactors that would bring down the cost and scale. It's important to do ITER. I'm going to get to my bottom line now because clearly I've run out of time. I don't know where my watch is. We have to do ITER. And ITER takes us down one route. But while we're doing ITER, unless we find a way to reduce the cost and the scale, we're producing an object that the market doesn't want. And therefore, we do have to focus. There is no reason we can't, from a theoretical physics point of view, while machines of this size cannot be engineered into fusion devices. What we don't know is how to confine a plasma that well in those to make that happen. And a huge fraction of our basic fusion program outside ITER has to focus on these issues, because otherwise, essentially, we have done that business of producing a scientifically demonstration that fusion is possible, but also a demonstration that it's not economically viable. I think there's some lovely ideas out there. The Swiss are making machines in which the triangularity goes the wrong way round and finding their confinement time went up by a factor of two. Nobody ever did it before. There's many things that we haven't tried, and we have to try them. And I'll go on. This is a picture of a spherical tokamak, and I just want to finish, and we'll take questions while this is showing. If this should. This one should. Yes, there it goes. This is the build of the mast upgrade at Cullum, which is, there are two very exciting machines happening in spherical tokamaks, which may show us the way to drive down the cost and scale of fusion. That is NSTX upgrade at here at Princeton, which is having a few teething problems, but they'll be sorted out shortly. And the mast upgrade at Cullum, and this is just a bit of fun. This is us getting mast upgrade out. We cut a hole in the concrete wall. We took it out of there about 2.5 years ago. We assembled the bottom plate, etc. That can go while I take questions, so thank you very much.
So I would say the normal constraints of economic viability may not really apply to fusion, because you need an alternative to fusion. You know, if you don't have fusion, If you imagine in a situation 100 years' time, sea level rising, you're not going to use carbon and gas and coal. You've run out of uranium, most likely. You're kind of petrified about fast breeders because of the proliferation risk. How are you going to make power to power the hospitals and whatever? So the price that you can charge or people are willing to pay also depends on how desperate they are for power and what are the alternatives. If there aren't alternatives, then the price is what you have to pay. There's an upper limit, however, which is, of course, you buy electricity to make something, to generate some economic activity. So if what you're making with electricity then is not going to find the market, if it costs you more in electricity than whatever you're making is going to sell for, then it doesn't. But I think people get too hung up on the normal constraints of economic activity because there isn't, so far, an alternative.
I do think prices are big because you can sell storage. You can put, you can build storage systems that just. I don't think it's irrelevant that, it would be very big and very expensive, very risky.
Yeah,
I take your point, and I don't know the answer, but I think, as a scientist working in the area, we should try and make it more and more attractive. And we've got this time while we're building ITER to focus on those kind of things.
Totally.
Steve, when you talk about the cost, on the other side is the cost of not doing anything. Building seawalls and raising roads and as the sea rises. And these are not negligible costs. If you match them against the costs that say are too high, would you have a chance for persuading the public to?
Maybe, and again, the same answer here was that's predicting what people will find tolerable in cost in the future. At the moment, the unattractiveness of a 9-meter demo is enough for me to say, we haven't finished the job.
Already spending money is hard.
But I hope you're both right. But I still think it's worth looking for something that can bring the scale down.
So, Steve, I'm totally with you, as opposed to sort of everyone else in the audience here, that we need to drive down the price of some commercial fusion system compared to Europe's crazy idea. I thought you'd enjoy it. I thought you'd like the way I put it there. And normally, as you know, my research finds disasters. But working with Matt Renke and others, I've come up with the result that actually, if you could make the machine smaller by making the field larger, the power loss problem gets easier. We can talk about that. But in the US, the MIT guys think higher magnetic fields, no problem, let me show you my design. And the guys in Europe say, higher magnetic fields, you've got to be out of your mind. But England, particularly now, is no longer Europe. Maybe you guys have an opinion about this question of higher magnetic fields. Can we build a reliable device with, say, 20 Tesla on the magnet? In the time frame we're talking about.
Well, 20% would be a lot of help, actually. It's amazing how, being at 40 is a lovely number, right?
I am greedy, I understand.
And so 20 Tesla might be out of line, but 16 would be terrific. Part of the problem is people who are telling, who are going around in Britain saying people will react. And they give me heart. And to go 0.6 meters across, you've got to have something like 26 Tesla on the board edge of the map. Mm-hmm. That's not.
But what do you think about 16? When 16, do you think?
16, I think we've made solenoids out of high-temperature superconductors more than a centimeter across at 16. So within a decade, we must.
So I have a comment and a question. So the comment, you mentioned that the UK is thinking about going with small modular nuclear reactors. And so one comment is that, I don't know if you've seen that the Andlinger Center has produced a distillate on small modular reactors. Okay. So you can go to the web and you can look, because there are comparisons that are very interesting. Comparing small modular reactor clusters of those to one larger reactor. And as you well know, based on even just your economics that you mentioned here, right now the nuclear energy industry has a negative learning coefficient, meaning, yes, you know, it's more expensive to build the next reactor than the previous one, yes, which is not the way it's supposed to work. The conclusion of that distillate that we wrote here, that Rob Sokolow led, was that it's not obvious that you'll get to a cheaper solution with small modular reactors. It's very depressing. You have to get to something like, if I remember correctly, 700, build 700 of them before you start to...
That's more than I've heard. The analysis by Atkins is written as
well. Well, okay, you have to look at this and see what you think, and I may be remembering the numbers wrong. So now to the science question. So you had this very nice simple analysis of what everything depends upon, and so you have a choice of field or size or this magical F, where the magic F, and the magic F, that's just a catch-all, right? Well, for the physics, there's no analytic expression for that, right? It's just that you know that there's a bunch of physics that depends on a bunch of different aspects of the problem. Is that correct?
So when the turbulence goes away, so we know that theoretically there's a long way from F dominated turbulence to F no turbulence.
So there's a lot of room for improvement. Okay.
In terms of turbulence, pressure, etc. Exactly how far along that turbulence. Yeah, we've explored a lot of that. I would never give up.
Through simulations or also experiments terms of exploring that range?
The twisted light, meaning these reverse triangularity discharge. Really very impressive finding without evidence. Those devices only be made in that machine, the only one that's got the coil configuration.
Just did the reverse.
But again, you know, it'll probably depend on detail, but I think there's room.
Hi, Steve. Nice talk. So I thought you were going to talking about F again. There was, in fact, work by Harry Minnick on stellarators using shaping as a free parameter, suppressing, and actually successful calculation of reducing turbulent transport.
Yeah.
And I actually just put this in my poster for the IAEA is a program for developing a smaller reactor. And of course, you probably also know that you know, current drive requirements for steady state tokamaks actually kind of drive that problem in the wrong direction. So anyways, I thought that's where you were going when you brought up F. I thought that's what you were going to talk about. But I don't know if you want to comment.
I have a question. Other than the ACEE, do I have other? Well, I wasn't going to talk about stellarite. There's a lot of room in stellarite. I've always thought that Princeton is one of the places where there is that kind of capability shown in the past. shame program is so locked down. It would be superb to have a CSX, which is actually a beautiful idea. Thank you.